Okay. Oops, I started this. All right, this is the second, basically, overview lecture. Previously, we went over Linux and everything you need to know. You've been going into, basically, how rootkits take over a Linux system. I didn't finish that last part. I'll probably finish that again next time. It's just probably 5-10 more minutes. But this time, we'll be going over, basically, the basics of Windows, covering, basically, system administration, security, and attack, and going in very in-depth into how rootkits basically take over a Windows system. We're going to start with memory handling. We're going to dive into the registry, probably one of the most important parts of Windows. What happens during Windows boot, Windows architecture, we'll go into Windows security, the Windows domain, and rootkits. So previously, we've been discussing every lecture various aspects of the disclosure debate. The link here links to basically events that have occurred since between 2011 up to last year. Basically what happened is that iPad owners that were going through AT&T for service basically were subject to a massive vulnerability on AT&T's website that a couple of vulnerability researchers, I say that this time with quotation marks with my fingers, because their IRC logs also showed that they were considering a lot of shady things. They actually were actively hacking AT&T's website to discover this vulnerability without AT&T's permission. And they claim they contacted AT&T and Apple disclosing this vulnerability. However, AT&T and Apple officially claimed that they never heard directly from the pair of researchers, and they found out about this vulnerability from the news reports that were released by the researchers. Mainly the researchers went to Gawker with a dump of iPad owners' personal information and said, hey, look what we found. There's a massive problem with this service. You all should see how horrible this security is. And they were prosecuted, and they were both convicted in that they are given guilty sentences, and they're convicted under the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act. I consider this a widely controversial law on the sole fact that it does not define authorization. If you do not define authorization in a law or statute, it can be very vague and it can be left up for any sort of manipulation by prosecution or defense. So they were convicted mainly because they had IRC logs showing that they were looking to, they were considering crashing Apple and AT&T stock by releasing a whole dump of user data, saying, look how bad their security is. No one should buy these products. No one should use an iPad with these services. And they were hoping that in theory, they saw that would cause their stock to crash. And what they're going to do is short sell it and basically make a ton of profit. Basically, it's manipulating the market and profiteering all in one. So they, in the IRC logs, agree that this is a terrible idea and you shouldn't do this, logically, because it's criminal. But anyways, for some reason, proceeded the way they did, and this is the worst example, perhaps in modern time, of vulnerability disclosure. If you claim you contacted the vendor, you need to have some way to prove that you did. It has to be email that you can prove that it occurs on some server, and it all has to check out. You can't just go to the news and say, look at all this user data, this is a horrible vulnerability, it's victimizing all these people, and by the way, here's some exploit code. Here's a script that will get it all. That's a terrible thing to do. So that being said, some corrections and comments from last time. Homework 1 is due January 24th, not the 25th. 25th is a Friday. 24th is a Thursday. So someone pointed that out. I'm fixing that now. I'm going to send out an email too. It's also due in class. Please type it out. I can read assembly code. I can reverse engineer malware. I can't read cursive. I can't reverse engineer chicken scrawl. I've been grading for a while, and cursive and handwriting always gives me the hardest problems. But I'll still grade it. Also, I talked about vulnerability disclosure and SCADA systems, specifically flight traffic control systems, specifically a recent DEF CON talk given by Renderman. I saw the talk in person. I thought it was awesome talk. It ended up causing a lot of good. They recently released the documentary trailer for DEF CON this year, and they interviewed him, and after his talk, I didn't get to see this, dozens of people came to him, just up to him on stage, and started talking to him from the industry, and he's been in contact with dozens of people that are actively trying to fix this and trying to make the skies safer. So in this instance, it caused a lot of good. I'm happy to see that. Okay, so before we dive in, these are the books that I used to build today's lecture, probably along with various lectures throughout this class. The Windows Internals books are great. They're great if you really want to get to know the insides of Linux, of Windows, as well as the rootkit arsenal. You really get to know the inside of Windows from the bad guy's perspective, and also the system administrator perspective of trying to defend against bad guy, because that book is very much cat and mouse. It's here's how attackers break into something, here's the countermeasure, here's the counter-countermeasure that bad guys use, here's the way the good guys defend against that and whatnot. And then the rest are used here and there. First thing is, next week is reverse engineering week, and the CS department is flying out and reverse engineering expert Mitch Adair. He gives various workshops around the country on reverse engineering. And if you can, find a laptop, borrow one for both Tuesday and Thursday's lecture next week. What you're going to need on it is you're going to need a virtual machine with a 32-bit version of Windows. I emailed you guys all this through Blackboard. If you don't check the email that goes through Blackboard, shoot me an email. I'll forward the email along to you so you have all the details and text with all the links to go to download the two tools. The two tools you're going to need is CFF Explorer and IDA Pro. There's a free trial. And to get 32-bit version of Windows, I've already contacted Systems Group. Just go to them, ask about MSDNA. It's basically the Microsoft Developers Software Alliance or something. I don't remember. Anyways, you can download all versions of Windows past, I think, XP, and 32, 64-bit version. And I made sure to tell them they need to get all of our paperwork for this class done quickly. So if you need an ISO to put into a virtual machine, just have a virtual machine running Windows, go to Systems Group and get that signed up.
Did you say Windows 7?
Windows XP, Vista, or 7, don't use Windows 8, because I don't know if these two tools that we're trying to use even work on Windows 8. So, and then if you need have any questions on setting up the virtual machine, about 512 megabytes of RAM and 5 to 8 gigabytes for the hard drive, I'd lean on 8 if you're downloading Vista or 7. Okay, let's see. Diving into the lecture, the aspects of memory handling that you need to be familiar with are the differences between segmentation and paging. It's not just so much in Windows, it's basically in operating systems. Windows tends to rely more on paging, but paging is basically memory divided into small partitions. They're all the same size, and they're referred to as page frames. When a process gets loaded, it gets split up into pages, and these pages get put into the frames. It's kind of straightforward. It's all transparent to the programmer, and that brings us to segmentation. All of you should be familiar with segmentation faults. Segmentations are basically memory that is allocated in various sizes, so not all fixed sizes, and it depends on the needs for the address space of a process. Segments can be individually protected or shared between processes, and segmentation faults occur when data that is about to be read or written is destined outside of the permitted address space for that process. So this somewhat involves the programmer. If you declare variables like int I equals 1 inside a function, not the main function, or not a global variable, that gets put on the stack when that function gets called. However, if you declare something dynamically with malloc, that gets put on the heap. Those are two different separate segments. So that's all we need to go over for that for now. The Windows NT family is huge. Some manager in Windows decided to stick NT on everything ever since NT. So Windows 7 has NT stuff all over it. And we'll see that throughout this lecture today. There are 32-bit versions, 64-bit versions, and there's home, professional, enterprise. There's data center versions for every single one of these server ones too. And the important thing you need to know is that they, even the 64-bit versions use something called Win32 API. They all use basically workgroups and Active Directory. They use Windows NT domains and ntdll.dll. We'll get into that soon. Windows is a multi-tier design. There's lots of layers. It's mostly implemented in C, somewhat in C++, and a little bit in ASM. Because it's mostly implemented in C, it could be considered not an object-oriented operating system, in the sense that C is not an object-oriented programming language. Windows can isolate chipset dependencies by using hardware abstraction layers. That's basically allows it to be deployed on such diverse hardware and have generally the same operation and features. And thus, it is designed to support many architectures, MIPS, Intel, IBM. Those all go historically across the versions. And all that support means lots of drivers, and that means lots of places to hide. And the most important thing is there's lots of backwards compatibility in Windows. And backwards compatibility is horrible for security. I mean, it's really, really horrible. Generally, the logic for backwards compatibility is, look, we can still make all this old stuff work and keep our customers happy. That way, when they upgrade, because we really want them to give us money, all their stuff doesn't break and they don't have to spend all this time redeveloping stuff. But also, what goes hand in hand more often than not is that let's just not bother keeping the old stuff that we're keeping backwards compatible up to date. So you have vulnerabilities that go across years. Although Windows, Microsoft is generally pretty good about fixing things. Here's some examples. Landman hashes. Those rose in the early Windows days and still stick around here and there today, even in Apple operating systems, just for backwards compatibility and interoperability. Then there's the PE file format. That's been around for 20 years or more. And the rest I'm sure we'll get to at some point. The main reasons, in my opinion, for Windows having so many security problems is that it's the big dog. If Linux was the number one operating system in the world for consumers, big business, small business, governments, it would be having just as many attacks as Windows. Same with Apple, same with anyone else. The second reason, however, is the massive size of the Windows operating system. There's so much code that statistically, every so many years the figure changes for number of bugs per thousands of lines of code, that you're guaranteed to basically find vulnerabilities in it if you look hard enough. And you don't have to look that hard, probably, if you're good. There are hundreds of drivers, and most are written by third parties. They're not written by Microsoft, but Microsoft has sold those vendors basically a code signing license so they can say, we wrote this, we're going to sign it, now Windows recognizes it and will install it, not some malware. However, they're written by third parties, and there's dozens of those, and those drivers themselves could have vulnerabilities and they could never get patched. There's all the backwards compatibility, user friendliness, auto runs features and problems, plug and play features, and that all makes it very target rich. And basically, one of the less known things is that historically, a lot of Microsoft products like Internet Explorer and Outlook are tied directly into the kernel. And the reason they did this is that so they would load faster than their competitors like Chrome and Firefox. That way they can, you know, release these commercials with, you know, I'm just too close to love you song playing and we load faster than everyone else because it directly ties into the kernel. However, that also exposes the kernel to vulnerabilities, any vulnerabilities perhaps that are not properly isolated from the vulnerabilities in those applications, i.e. Outlook, etc. But in my opinion, it's pretty secure. Really, it's a pretty secure operating system. However, critics complain that really the main problems with Windows security is that many things that tie all together were designed with no security in mind, like inter-process communication, ActiveX, object linking, embedding, control extension, and stuff like that. And that's somewhat true, but I'm sure it all wasn't designed without security in mind. So let's get into the basics of Windows, what you need to start off knowing. You need to know the registry. You need to know the swell. This is basically the brainstem and the entire nervous system of a computer that runs Windows. You use regedit.exe to basically view and modify the kernel, and there are five hives. They're called hives because some developer in the early days of Windows was terribly afraid of bees, and they decided to troll that developer by naming the core of Windows hives, and various other things relating to it involving bees and stuff like that. But hives has remained today. It kind of works. There are five key hives. They're all starting with H key, which usually gets acronymed into HK, and then whatever follows. The registry works with access control, group policy settings, local security settings, permissions, and user rights assignments. And it basically is used to define everything the computer and the user cannot and can do. The registry entries are basically associative arrays that hold abstract data types, and these can hold collections of objects. In other words, they can contain hives themselves, they contain subkeys, and those can contain values. So let's get into the hives. The classes root hive is basically for file type association. When you double click on some sort of file, that's what Windows goes to say, hey, I'm supposed to use this application to open it. Current user contains preferences and settings for the currently logged on user. Its supporting files are basically ntuser.dat and the log for that. HKey local machine is for plug and play and HAL, hardware abstraction layer info. Basically, it contains all the information about software, hardware, and security on the system. It also pulls info from four other hives: system, software, security, and SAM, which is Security Accounts Manager. Is one of the most important hive structures. Yeah, question.
You say it pulls info from other hives, are those like sub-hives?
Yes. Oh. So, here, this slide's about that. HKey local machine, HKLM for short. The SAM, basically the following files are SAM, SAM.log, SAM.save. The sub hive security has files security. And all these are stored in basically C, Windows, System32 config. The shortcut at the bottom, percent sign, system root, percent sign, is basically one of the many shortcuts used in accessing and pointing to directories. I believe it's just an environmental variable that gets mapped to wherever Windows is installed, and various other things that are shortcutted. And so all these hives have files that are used to populate them, and they're all stored there.
Is the SAV file a backup of the data?
Yes. .sav is basically a backup version. All right. Question?
Is there any way like that Windows protects those files or like encrypting?
We'll get into that, yes. So HKey users contains everything about every user in the SAM. It contains info for that user's desktop, their environment, their variables, program settings, network connections, printers. Current config contains all plug and play data about systems hardware devices that are used in the loading and startup process. And here's some important things you need to know. Every time a user logs in, a new hive, basically a new user profile hive, is dynamically built for that user. User may already exist, may have already logged in before, but every time that user logs in, it dynamically builds that registry hive. And in general, every time the system boots, it doesn't read the registry all from some static file on the hard drive. It's dynamically building it from all these files and from startup services, that startup systems and subsystems and services that are all brought up at boot to gather information about things that have been plugged in, the current hardware setup, network setup, and et cetera.
Each of those five hives is recreated from scratch?
Not from scratch. There's still some info about, there's some generic info stored on the hard drive in each of these files. The major hives have their own files, but for the most part, they all are recreated from scratch. Keep going. There we go. I don't know. Must have lost focus. So let's go into the Windows boot, because that process builds the registry. As we discussed previously, the BIOS does post, does CMOS, then it points to the main boot record. For Windows, it points to the boot manager, the Windows boot manager, which is boot MGR. Boot manager loads and reads the boot configuration data. BCD file is basically stored, I think, in System32 config as well. A lot of things are stored there. The BCD store reads which operating systems are specified in the BCD store file. So you could edit it to say, I also have, I'm a dual boot system, and there's a Linux partition here as well. And it displays a menu to select which one for the user. Then the boot manager resumes upon OS selection, if there is any prompted, and loads winload.exe, which is the Windows bootloader. Winload.exe loads the kernel, which for Windows predominantly is NTOS KRNL, basically NT operating system kernel. And that loads, winload also loads hal.dll. DLLs are dynamically linked libraries. We'll get into that soon. And then it loads the system registry hive. These processes are used to create the registry key, HKEY local machine system. And winload uses the system key to load any device drivers into memory, but it doesn't start them yet. So then winload checks if the user basically wants to start using a last known good configuration, and you can enter safe mode at this point. So at this point, drivers have been loaded into memory, they haven't started yet, and you can choose whether or not you want to use safe mode. And then if you choose normal boot, basically winload starts the memory paging, which is pagefile.sys. .sys files are essentially kernel mode drivers. We'll get into that at the end. And then it also starts the startup, it basically passes along to the kernel, the control of the CPU. So then the kernel causes the hardware abstraction layer, DLL, to become active, and that builds the HKEY local machine hardware hive, and that builds it from all the information collected thus far. So that's information provided by the BIOS, provided by files on the system, and last known configuration. Okay, so the kernel after that starts critical services and drivers. All of those are located in a Windows System32 drivers. And most drivers are .sys files. The kernel then starts the session manager subsystem. Most exes, when you see them in Windows, if they have ss.exe, it usually means subsystem, or some sort of subsystem. So smss.exe is extremely important. It is the first native application. Basically, native applications are as close to kernel mode as you can get. This system starts both the kernel and user modes of the Windows 32 subsystem. So the files for that are win32k.sys is kernel mode. That has all the functions, routines, and data structures used to regulate and operate the kernel mode of the Windows executable. And then winservdll and csrss.exe are both the predominant systems used for operating and regulating user mode. Another important thing it does that sometimes malware takes advantage of is that it reads the registry thus far and looks under this registry value, local machine system, current control set, control session manager, subsystems. Any systems that are specified with the key required are then loaded into memory and started. This subsystem also creates all environment variables and the virtual memory paging files. It does a lot. It's responsible for handling sessions running on a machine, and it is a common target for malware. Why does it keep doing that? The next thing it does, the session manager subsystem starts the Win32 graphics subsystem. And then it starts the client-server runtime subsystem. This, like I said before, is one of the main things that provides the user mode side of Windows 32. And it also handles console handling and GUI shutdown. Those are the two main things it handles. It is also the second native application. We'll formally define native application in a few slides. Then SMSS starts winlogon, basically the login manager, and it also starts services.exe, which is the service control manager. Once the winlogon is up and running, it starts lsas.exe. LSAS is something we'll probably come to a number of times in this class. It's a local security and authority process. Local security, yeah, I said it right. And it is, let's see, we'll probably cover the Metasploit post-exploitation modules that are used to attack user name and password data that's stored in memory by getting LSAS to dump secrets from memory. It's predominantly responsible for displaying the logon screen, prompting users for user ID and password, and then handling any authentication. Or passing the authentication off to any appropriate services or subsystems. Then winlogon, once the user logs in, executes userinit.exe, and that applies group policy settings, startup and policy settings that are stored in the local user registry, and it is not overridden by Active Directory group policy. We're gonna get into Active Directory. Explaining this, I'll release the video for this lecture later. Windows is like a web of complicated and confusing and redundant systems. I mean, it's really complicated. I'm mentioning a bunch of things that are acronyms you probably don't understand now. I'm going to be explaining them later. So once you've heard this lecture, it may help you to go through and just skim through the video again, view the first half of this stuff so you get the full picture. So finally, winlogon launches explorer.exe, which is basically the graphical user interface and window manager. And I know it's a lot of information to take in. That's why I'm video recording it. Probably not going to test you what happens in step 20. I'm not that kind of guy. So I know it's like drinking from a fire hose. So subsystem startup is started by also the session manager subsystem. And let's get into that. This big ugly graph is from Windows XP in 2000 era. I have another similar one for Vista and 7. I have no idea what Windows 8 is like. I really have no idea. They haven't released the internals book for that, and that's not coming out probably anytime soon. But it should, in theory, be very similar to the core things that are represented here. At the top, you have user mode. Above this line, at the bottom you have kernel mode.
all basically user mode systems and services interface with the kernel through two APIs. The first one is the Win32 API. The second one is the NTDLL API. This one is basically closed source and undocumented by Windows, and they provide the Win32 API, which is all these subsystem DLLs, to communicate with the NTDLL, and that handles communicating with the kernel. Basically, it's just a programming interface for how Windows handles everything. So here's the one for current systems, Windows 7 and Vista. And you can see much better in this diagram that all these subsystems, whether it's environmental subsystems, applications, service subsystems, or system process subsystems, they all communicate with the kernel through Windows DLLs. Very rarely do they ever bypass an NTDLL. NTDLL usually handles all communications with the kernel for anything in user mode.
Question.
So is it common attack to like corrupt the DLL?
Yes.
Those are good communications with the kernel?
Yes. We'll get into rootkit design and how all the horrible things that can happen to Windows actually happen. Yes.
I'm assuming there's an API that NTDLL uses.
Yes, it is.
Is it common for malware to bypass NTDLL and try to interact with that API directly?
Basically, the internal kernel API, mm-hmm. just like NTDLL, NTDLL's API is undocumented mm-hmm. by Microsoft. It's well documented on the underground. The kernel API, basically system calls and stuff like that, there's sufficient documentation out there because third parties have to program drivers and they basically have to know how IO request packets are sent. That's basically when drivers operate, they send packets between each other and processes. Packets don't just really don't extend to the internet. They also apply to internal the workings of an internal system. Basically, on a motherboard, everything operates on a bus. And that can be seen kind of as like a medium that everyone shares. So they have to share it by sending packets, just like we share connections to the internet. So there has to be sufficient documentation for that, for third parties to develop drivers. But for some of the really core systems, Windows actually goes so far to obfuscate many of the binaries for things, especially for things to protect and harden the kernel. Because once you get a rootkit at some level, you have ring zero access. We discussed it in the last lecture, a lot of you guys weren't here. Ring zero access is the highest level access you can have within an operating system. User mode is at ring 3. There are things that exist above ring zero, such as ring -1 and -2. Which is basically BIOS and SMM. We might get to that. So if you're operating at ring zero and you have some sort of control over the system, you can turn off other things that are ring zero, such as system security protections. And we'll get into that. So you can see the NTDLL basically handles communication to the system service dispatcher. And basically there's a system call that's an interrupt that's basically sysenter that is called at the assembly level every time there's a switch from user mode to kernel mode. And I'll show you guys that in the rootkit section. And then there's all these managers. There's advanced local procedure call tables. There's configuration manager. There's process manager that handles scheduling and process control. There's the memory manager, and there's a security reference monitor, there's plug and play manager, object manager, and et cetera, et cetera. And then there's the kernel and the hardware abstraction layer. So those Windows DLLs at the top, the subsystem DLLs at the top, those make up the Windows 32 API. They're very well documented. They're provided for people to have just enough information to program basically anything they want on Windows. And that's a better, I guess, diagram showing you exactly what they are. So environment subsystems are interesting. I'm going to go back a couple slides. Here we have environment subsystems. OS2 and POSIX mean basically they're subsystems for explicitly for compatibility with OS2 operating systems, or OS2, you know, using operating systems, and POSIX also using operating systems. And here, SUA stands for Subsystem for Unix-based Applications. So there's some sort of support for Unix built into Windows through that subsystem. So this is probably the best explanation for Windows 32 API and the native API. Native API is the NTDLL one. So I hope everyone's seen Office Space. The two guys on the left are basically re-interviewing the guy on the right for his job, and they ask him, so what do you do here? And he says, I take what the clients say, what the customers say, and I tell it to the engineers. And they ask, why can't the clients just talk directly to engineers? He's like, that doesn't make any sense. And he goes on this tirade that basically has no argument to it, and he loses his job. Windows 32 API solely exists really for security in depth. Basically, they're trying to abstract to basically minimize as much permission as you need for users to handle all the applications they need, and trying to basically abstract out anything that deals directly with the kernel into the NTDLL, into that native API, while also leaving it basically undocumented, hoping that security through obscurity does them some good. Keyboard keeps, I guess, not responding. So this is the breakdown of the eight categories of functions that are provided by the Windows 32 API. There's not eight files for the Windows 32 API, but there's eight basically categories of things that it does. There's the base services for file system handling, handling devices, also processes, threads, and error handling. There's advanced services for dealing with the registry, basically power management as well. There's also service management and user account management. There's graphic device interface functions, basically for handling monitor output, also printers. Then, aside from that, there's the user interface, so windows, buttons, menus, scroll bars, etc. There's also the common control library, which basically handles loading bars, status bars, toolbars, and tabs. It's very related to the user interface library. Then the common dialog box is basically dialog boxes Windows encountered an error. Would you like to send Microsoft some info so we cannot do anything about it? Kind of dialog boxes. Then there's Windows shell functionality, which handles operating system shell. And that's handled in those DLLs, shell 32 and shell WAPI. And then there's finally network services for handling all sorts of things. And that's predominantly Net API 32. But I think the main files break down to the ones that are most commonly used are kernel 32.dll. That is not kernel mode DL. That's for user mode. It exports most of the Win32 base API. Predominantly memory management, input-output, process handling, and synchronization. And also user 32.dll, which handles exporting functions that create and manipulate the Windows user interface. So let's get to NTDLL. Like I said, it's mostly undocumented by Microsoft, but it's historically been well-documented across all versions of Windows. I don't know about 7, I haven't looked into any of that on the underground. The majority of applications do not directly call ntdll.dll. Applications that link or call ntdll directly are called native applications. Native applications cannot be run or started by the user. So smss.exe and csrss.exe, you can't start them up as the user. So if you try to kill them and then restart them, I think it'll just BSOD, blue screen of death. So the vast majority of exported functions by NTDLL's API are prefixed with NT. So you have NT display string, NT read file, and NT write file. So the Win32 API function read file calls NTDL's function NT read file. And likewise, write file calls NTDL's NT write file. It's pretty straightforward. You can imagine why, even though they left NTDL undocumented, it's pretty easy to figure out what's going on because things are so verbosely named.
Why you cannot directly run application? Why you cannot run it directly? Yeah, because some symbols are logic problem.
Say that again.
Why you cannot run a native application?
That's a security control built into the Windows executive. That's basically a kernel restriction.
Okay, so if you try to start it,
Even if you have administrator privileges, it's not going to let you.
So we just don't create the process.
I think it's one of those things that if it ever dies, it restarts itself.
Yeah.
So yeah. If you manage to kill it, like with fire, and keep it dead, like a headshot to a zombie, it's probably going to at some point cause your system to crash. So let's talk about exported functions, because this is how APIs are provided, and you probably haven't covered this in any of your classes. EXE files and DLLs both have the functionality to export functions to interact with other programs and code. It's very rare for EXEs to export functions. Sometimes malware does this, because it's a very little known feature in portable executable files. And if malware does export functions, they will almost always use intentionally misleading function names. Like read file will actually be like OpenSocket for a listener. Yes?
In a technical sense, aren't EXE and DLLs just like there's a flag in the PE header or something, and that's like the major difference between them or something?
Yes. So portable executable, this file format has been around for, I think, 20 plus years. The following files are all portable executable files. You have EXEs and DLLs. Really, the difference is, I guess, a flag that differentiates the two. But also, they predominantly, on average, have different sections that they use. There's also CPL, OCX, .sys. Like I said, those are kernel mode drivers, .scr, I have no idea what that is. I can't remember what that is. I should know. Anyways, and then DRV, pretty sure that's user mode driver. It contains information as to what functions are also imported as well as exported in its headers. These are contained in call tables. In user mode, it's the import address table, the IAT. I'll get to that in a second. So when reverse engineering portable executables, especially for malware, looking at the functions that it imports is very informative. If you think something's malware and you want to gain more information as to how it behaves, if it imports functions that create files, write files, or read files, you know right there that it may be doing something on the disk. As well as if it has functions that basically open sockets, it may also be doing some network communication. There's also functions that are giveaways for editing the registry, and I have tables for all that. So malware can also play tricks by importing functions by indirect reference. In essence, basically import the sixth function from this DLL. It's not going to basically say import create file w, it's whatever the sixth function happens to be. It could be the sixth function squared divided by 3, something like that. or offset by a hex address. So when applications are compiled, the API calls do not use hard-coded addresses. So these DLLs, these dynamically linked libraries, when the binary is run, when the application is run, they're linked in when it's running into memory. They're not loaded into the machine code for the application, because if you did that for every single application, the size of applications would probably be 5 megs minimum, because there's so many functions in these DLLs. That's the entire reason why dynamically linked libraries and shared objects came along very early in the computing industry. So since they're not hard-coded addresses, they basically work through a function pointer. They're organized in the import address table, and this way the API call doesn't have to be touched up by the compiler with the correct jump address for the API code. Packed executables are known to mess with the process IAT table to make it smaller, sometimes to cut out unnecessary stuff. So here's some interesting functions that malware may often use. Like I said, functions for creating files, for reading files, for writing files. The second and the third one are interesting. Find first file W and find next file W. Those are actually used for traversing directories. So find the first file in a directory, then file the next, and then find the next, and the next, and the next. Basically iterate through it. And then there's get process heap, and open process. Those are all used for manipulating processes. From user32.dll, the previous one was kernel32.dll. This one is basically for user environment GUI. Even though malware may have GUI manipulation functions, it doesn't mean it's providing a GUI to the user. The GUI could be hidden from the user, yet could have other functionalities that are common in a GUI. The second to last one, set Windows hook XW, is very important. It's for setting, it's an API call that malware often uses for key logging. It's primarily used in spyware. So it basically creates a hook. I covered hooks roughly last time, but for the half of the class that wasn't here, hooks are basically when you have an entry in the call table, you have the function name and then the address for that routine. If you want to use that function, basically you jump to that provided address in the entry. When you want to hook that, you override it with the address for your hook, and you do some, you can have some code there, and then you can jump to the original address for that that API routine. So basically, it allows you to run some code first, and then run the API call, or not run the API call and just return. Let's see, ADV API 32. I think that stands for Advanced API 32. I don't know why. Some things get named silly things. But every single one of these functions is for editing the registry. So remember how I said the service manager subsystem looks for all the things in that one registry chain that are listed as required subsystems, and then loads them every time on boot. So if something's editing that, they would be using these, that malware would be using these functions. I'm not gonna test you on these functions. What does this one do? Even though they're pretty verbosely named. This is all listed for reference in case you guys wanna do any malware reverse engineering projects. Shell 32 is mainly for launching other applications. Basically for performing operations on a specified file to notifying the current application that's calling the second function here, SH change notify. It causes basically that application to be notified every time some event happens. So let's get to security in Windows 7. Over the years, there's been a lot of development. The top five things we're going to get to in exploit development, but basically there's data execution prevention, address space layer, layout randomization. There's the GS compiler option, safe SEH, kernel patch protection, and the advanced mitigation experience toolkit, among others. But mainly we're going to get into the user account control. The UAC, that's what some consider the annoying little thing that comes up when you double click on exe file that says, are you sure you want to run this? We don't know who published this, or we do know how to publish this because we can view the certificate and there's the signature for the code that matches. As well as this application wants to open a port through the firewall or make an outgoing connection. Those are examples of the consent prompts. Also prompts for administrator access. The security accounts manager, it is responsible for storing the user's passwords in a hash format. The SAM file is stored in system root, system32, config, just like how Linux, we discussed the etsy password file and the shadow file. We're going to discuss the landman hash, which was a terrible idea. I don't know who thought of it. Really just a terrible idea. And then the NT landman hash, which came along, which used some more, at the time, more advanced crypto techniques, but all the NT landman protocols for Active Directory have been 100% broken at some point to date, and that's why they now default to Kerberos. So the Windows kernel has an exclusive file system lock on the SAM file to prevent any sort of opening or any sort of copying, basically any sort of file operation while Windows is running. If you want to edit the SAM file, you basically have to boot to some live CD or some other partition, mount that file system, and then edit the SAM file while Windows is not running. In order to basically add salt, or rather more security, the syskey function was introduced, and the algorithm for this is basically the on-disk copy of the SAM file is partially encrypted with the key called the syskey, and the in-memory version of the SAM is, I'm pretty sure, not. It should be noted that the in-version memory of SAM can be dumped while Windows is running via the PW dump tool, and I'm sure some Metasploit modules. In Windows 2000 and before, if an attacker simply deleted the SAM file, no passwords were required for login. It's just like, okay, everything looks gravy. So I think better desktop auditing is one of the better things that Windows has provided. The logs for Windows are XML-based, and all tasks that are running are tied to an event. There's fine-grained support for auditing administrator privileges, so businesses with large IT departments that have a wide amount of employees running as administrator, there's fine-grained log auditing for exactly who's doing what at administrator access. There's also better filtering with this, so it's much easier to filter out the noise and find the events that you want. I say even easier than any Linux system. And there's, in Windows 7, been entirely reworked event viewer. I, however, prefer using Splunk. Splunk is a free tool that basically runs a local web application that provides really nice GUI, really nice chart graphing for system logs, and you can create basically views based on log categories. There's thousands of log categories, and most of them are just taken up by drivers, so you can filter out a lot of noise that way. Another thing in modern Windows system is the network access protection. This is mainly for enterprise systems. Basically, when a new computer connects to the domain, the network access protection system basically checks all of its security policies to make sure that they meet the corporate policy. Basically, the access control policies that are listed in the registry. And also make sure that they are fully patched with the latest service packs and critical updates and have up-to-date antivirus. Which makes it really great for system administration. Another thing that makes it really great for system administration and attackers is the direct access feature, is that basically IT departments can, through the GUI, have direct access to any computer on the domain and can take complete control, and it can all happen completely seamlessly to the user. It doesn't necessarily have to dominate the user's mouse and keyboard and everything. The user can keep doing what they're doing, and basically the IT guy gets a second view of the computer, a new desktop and everything else, and can do whatever they want. So if an attacker compromises an IT department's machine, they could use this to pivot into other systems. App Locker is a very good feature. It basically allows for blacklisting, whitelisting of applications, and also for enforcing publisher rules based off digital signatures. It helps IT eliminate the unknown and unverified applications in the network, basically keeping your employees from downloading LimeWire and getting your company into trouble, as well as downloading all the malware that comes with that. The rights management service is a fine-grained access control for documents, can control whether users want to copy, I mean, whether users can copy, print, open, edit, etc., a document. BitLocker is also very important, especially for laptops and even thumb drives. It offers full hard drive encryption and is focused on mainly protecting the OS volume, though for laptops, it's important to have any data volumes also protected with hard drive encryption in case they get lost. Say it's a government laptop and it gets lost and missile codes are stolen, it's not a good thing. It's not as uncommon as you think. Bill Clinton actually lost the card with the nuclear, with the football. Does everyone know what the football is? It's a briefcase, it's like handcuffed to Secret Service members, arm at all times. Basically, East drinks, lives, sleeps with it on. I mean, they take turns. But only the president has the access code to open up the briefcase. Well, he sent his suit to the dry cleaners outside of the White House, and he left it in there, and they lost it for, I think, 3 months. Yeah, so I mean, it's not unheard of. If anyone, you could probably Google that pretty easily. I don't need to find it for you guys. So for things like thumb drives, you could lose it and not find out that you've lost it for weeks, and you could have important documents. So BitLocker is a really great Windows standard feature that can lock down thumb drives. And one of the most important things in system administration that we covered previously is least privilege. Least privilege is implemented through basically the access control lists in Windows. In the Linux lecture, we discussed how access control lists are not enabled by default for all users. So the Unix permission model is owner, group, and everyone else. So if you wanted to give specific permissions to one other user, you'd either have to create a group with just you and him in it, or let him own a version of the file. With access control lists in Linux, it allows you to basically specify specific permissions for that other user and for other different groups. It's very flexible. And so likewise, access control lists in Windows are very much the same. Access control entries are basically entries in the access control lists, and they control or monitor access to an object by a specified trustee. Trustee means basically user. So the main entries, the main information in ACE entries are the SID. It's basically the security identifier for the trustee. It's kind of similar to the UID for users in Linux, which is the user ID. There's the access mask. That's very similar to the permissions mask in Unix. So I'm sure you all have seen like chmod 755 some file. Basically, the numbers go through 0 to 7, and they specify basically bitwise permissions for user, group, and other. So there's an access mask that specifies the access rights for files, or rather objects. And then there are six types of ACE flags. There's flags to dictate which type of entry it is. And then there's sets of flags to dictate whether the access control entry applies to child containers and directories. And this is somewhat straightforward. It's also very important for application development. So I'm going to try and breeze through the rest and get to the good stuff. So domains, work groups, and home groups. I'm sure you've heard these terms at some point and wondered what's the difference. So all computers running on a Windows network, all computers running Windows on any network must be part of a work group or a domain. They can be part of a home group also, but it's not required. It's required for them to be either part of a work group or a domain. So in work group, all PCs are peers. No PC has control of another. That's the main things. In order to log on to a different PC, you must have an account on that PC. Home group, basically you must belong to a work group as well, so all those permissions, all those requirements apply. Main purpose here is to make it easier to share pictures, music, videos, documents, printers. Home group is password protected. Work groups are not password protected. But for home groups, you only have to type it in once when you first add it to the home group. So you can reboot many times. You only had to type it in that one time initially. Domains are what we're going to dive into. So you know, on a domain, there one or more PCs are the domain servers, basically the Active Directory servers. Those are controlled by network admins that use the servers to control the security and permissions for all the computers in the domain. Any changes to those policies are automatically made to all the PCs in the domain that are currently on and as they come online. Password credentials are required every time you log on to a PC in a domain. And if a user has a domain account, then he or she can log on to any PC in the domain. Basically, authentication is handled by one of those domain servers. So history of the Windows domain is basically Microsoft wanted a way to make everything just work seamlessly together. You plug it into the network and you start sharing, collaborating, etc. Started with LANMAN, then NT-LANMAN. Database history is mainly what everything ships with now is Active Directory. Servers that run Active Directory, the Active Directory servers are called domain controllers. So that handles the authentication and policy for system administrators. It is predominantly built on top of LDAP, Kerberos, and DNS. And the stuff at the bottom is just old stuff. So, domain connections can be supported over LAN, WAN, or VPN between networks. That makes it a pivoting target. So, here's the history for the security protocols for active domain and what happened prior to it. LANMAN was first. Its hashes were notoriously weak, made it really easy to crack passwords. It still appears in some places, even to date, even in Apple operating systems. I think Carlos Perez had a good talk, I forget where, on post-exploitation in Apple OS. Basically, you flip a registry flag and it takes the password stored in memory and restores them on hard disk in LANMAN, which is way easier to break than everything else that is used, just for backwards compatibility. Then NT LANMAN version 1 and version 2 were introduced. Version 2 used HMAC MD5 for authentication, CRC and message digest algorithms for integrity, and RC4 for encryption. And their sessions were very similar to MSChat V2. All of those acronyms that I said thus far have been broken. That's all you need to know. Ever since Windows 2000, Kerberos has been adopted. Almost out of time, so I'm going to get to the rootkits part and start that next time. That's actually the interesting stuff. So Kerberos has replaced NTLandMan as the default authentication protocol for Active Directory for working in a domain. However, NTLandMan is used widely and by default in instances where the client cannot access a domain controller, it defaults to NTLandMan. So remember, all that stuff has been broken at some point. There have been fixes that have come out to fix some of the problems, but they're built off basically insecure foundations. Also, it defaults to it when it's authenticating to a server using just an IP address. When it is authenticating to an Active Directory for us that has basically backwards compatibility legacy stuff that still uses the NTLandMan stuff, and is authenticating to a server that is not part of any domain, or, most interestingly, cannot access Kerberos ports due to a firewall. So if an attacker can change your firewall and disable those ports, it might cause your system to default to the less secure protocol. Question?
What if it was like a denial of service, block those like externally?
That's just as easy. You can basically block all the ports and then change the password and shut out the you know, system administrator. Logically, what's going to happen is he's just going to walk over to the router after about 30 minutes of banging his head on the keyboard and then reset the thing and then be like, hey, my password's not working. I'm just going to hardware factory reset it and then set it back up. So, I mean, yeah, I'm just talking about something that could be used more covertly that can allow you to gain access to those systems instead of just to deny everything, which can be more useful for attackers. And it's something as system administrators and incident responders you have to be aware of. So Windows Firewall is on by default in Windows 7 and post versions. There are different profiles for home, work, and public. It's really interesting because it allows users a lot of flexibility and it's much easier to configure than IP tables and any GUI-based Linux firewall editor. The most important thing is it ties connections to applications. So it monitors connections that are incoming and outgoing and can require user consent, basically the user access control, the UAC consent prompts. Also, another good thing it does is application whitelists. I'm a huge fan of whitelists. So we're about to get into the rootkit part, and we have about a minute left. Oh wait, no, we go to 15, not 10. So I'll go for a while. Okay. So most of the time when things go wrong, you can fix it with system restore. Even if you get ransomware and spyware. However, we want to know about the ugly. We want to know about rootkits. We want to know about the really bad stuff. Do we want to dive into the deep end and at the risk of all of our brain cells and sanity? So who builds rootkits? Oddly enough, marketing departments, and they probably have no idea what security is, and this has been used for also digital rights management. Sony did this in one of their MMOs for a feature for also anti-cheating. It's also used by law enforcement, industrial espionage, political espionage, and cybercrime. I'm sure you can imagine who does all the espionage. So let's discuss how attackers get into the kernel. I've discussed the term kernel mode driver several times so far. And in this diagram, you see the Win32 API and the NTDLL. And we're going to get into the kernel. So kernel mode drivers are an official channel. It's a sanctioned channel by Microsoft for system engineers to gain access to hardware, to gain access to ring zero permissions. It can be loaded by user, kernel mode drivers can be loaded by user mode applications, and kernel mode drivers are like training wheels for rootkit design. Anyone who's going into rootkit design should probably buy the rootkit arsenal. There's a huge chapter on beginning with a rootkit design using kernel mode drivers. And also, all throughout is attack defense. Basically, this is how you defend against this. This is how you attack the defenses. It's a really good read. Kernel mode drivers are usually .sys files, and those are all located in Windows System 32 drivers. A kernel mode driver rootkit offers high complexity in that there's a lot of capabilities. There's a lot of complex capabilities that are afforded to the attacker. The cost is that it's not stealthy. Loading something via the sanction channels is very well documented in all the user logs and will typically generate flags or, if not, alerts. The bonus is they're not difficult to code. They're surprisingly easy. Like all the sample code in the rootkit arsenal book for kernel mode drivers is probably one-page code. It's surprisingly easy. So here's exactly what happens. So when a user exe wants to basically load a kernel mode driver, it makes the necessary call to the Windows 32 API, and that calls in turn the NTDLL native API, and then it enters the kernel with this the system call sysenter. Then the kernel, the inside kernel API handles it with basically kernel interface fast call entry function, which interfaces with the kernel system calls. And that handles it basically off to the input-output manager. And I have these things in parentheses. Basically, it means it starts with capital NT, and then the function names start after that, but that's typically what they start with if you have to identify them. IO manager functions likewise start with IO as a prefix. And then the IO manager and all kernel mode drivers communicate with each other with IO request packets, IRP. Then kernel mode drivers interface with the hardware abstraction layer, and then hardware is touched. So, it's not hard to combat this. Microsoft came out with kernel mode code signing. I'm a big fan of code signing. It works. It's a very good security mechanism. It associates drivers or code that's signed with its authors and vendors. And if you need to basically revoke the trust, you can blacklist the certificate that's used to sign it, or have the certificate authority revoke it. Hopefully they don't use one like Komodo and they take forever. No, I'm just joking. I don't know how long they take. But when 64-bit Windows came out, Microsoft released this, and it basically requires all kernel mode drivers to be digitally signed with the Software Publishing Certificate, SPC. So it's not applicable to 32-bit versions of Windows. However, all versions of Windows, 64-bit and 32-bit, require basically a subset of all the core system binaries, as well as the boot drivers, to be signed by Software Publishing Certificates. However, even though something's signed, attackers can still piggyback on signed drivers that are vulnerable. So, countermeasures for kernel mode code signing. Well, we'll stop there because it's 12:15. So we'll pick up here next time. Any questions? Yeah?
Where's this in
Love? It's not in Love, it's the Carruthers building. So you go across the parking lot, go up the stairs, turn left, it's the first room on the left.
There's a term that we get XP or 7 for the virtual machine.
So for next week, either XP, Vista, or 7.
So it doesn't matter.
Doesn't matter. As long as it's 32-bit. It's only because the tools work on all three of those. 8 is available, but we don't know if 8 work. Those tools work on 8.
All right, thanks.
Sure. I've been talking to him, and he's all good to go. I'm going to make sure he's scheduled.